Good morning, everybody. Would you stand and sing with us? Of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature's unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night? None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We worship you. We thank you for this new year, and we look forward to seeing your work in our lives and your work in the community around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Morning, everyone. That one, was so small I couldn't see it. Welcome everybody to Mountain Christian. It's good to see everyone this morning. Just a quick few announcements and then we'll get back to worshiping our Lord and Savior. First of all, if you're new here and you're just looking to figure out some more information or get connected or you have some prayer requests, please fill this out. You can drop it in the box back there in the corner by the door. We'll be in prayer and praise with you. And then if you're looking just for more information on how to get plugged in, please do that. Also, as a resource is this bulletin. All sorts of information on here about different ministries, Sunday schools, contact information, a little bit about our mission here and vision to see lives transformed for the glory of God in our church. Some announcements for everyone to be aware of. January 23rd, the Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, we're celebrating. Baby bottles in the back to be filled. Those donations go to that ministry. A Montoya cookie, this is part of our Shine ministry where we as a church get involved in local schools to show the love of Christ. And so we're actively engaged with A Montoya there to support them and serve them. And so you can see there more about we bring the staff cookies there. And so if that's something you like to do, see the announcement there. Also, we have a missions open house. Lots of different international missions that you can get involved in here, even locally. So there's an open house there if you want to find out more information, again, help serve and then be transformed in the body of Christ. Will you stand this morning and let's go back to the Lord and worship this morning. Lord, we come to you and we lift you up, Lord. Lord, so many opportunities, Lord, to serve. Lord, you served us in so many ways, Lord. You could have stayed up in heaven and just, Lord, watch us, Lord, just disintegrate. But you didn't, Lord. You came, Lord, you died on the cross for us. You served us, Lord. You came and washed our sin away, Lord. Lord, that we can have relationship with you, Lord, that we can have relationship with one another. Lord, may we have a servant's heart in what we do. Lord, may we serve you this morning as we worship you. Lord, in song, Lord, by reading your word, and Lord, taking your communion this morning. Lord, help us do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before we get back into worship, Emily and I just want to talk a little bit about the missions open house that's coming up. So, oh, and Robbie's going to help too. Yeah. So we've been coming to Mountain Christian for about 5 years, and before we were a part of this church, we were a part of a Southern Baptist church that did missions differently than Mountain Christian does. You know, with the Southern Baptist churches, you all pull your money together and you send it to the convention, and then they sort of manage all those funds to deploy missionaries around the world. And while there's certainly a lot of benefits to that, and they do a lot of great work, we were struck by the relationship aspect here at Mountain Christian behind how Mountain Christian does missions. And so there's this missions program book, and it shows all the different ministries that Mountain Christian has built relationships with over the years. One of those is the Genesis of Hope, which we have a close connection with in India. But Emily's going to tell you a little bit more about the open house that's coming up.
Yeah. So one of the things that the missions team is responsible for is keeping personal relationships with the ministry partners that we have all over the world. There's 7 ministry partners. And also communicating all that's going on with the congregation here at Mountain Christian. And then the last couple of years, we've lost a number of key people on our team, and so we feel like in order to continue doing those two jobs well, we really would like to invite some of you to join us on that team. And to that end, we're inviting you to one of our monthly meetings on January 26th, Wednesday, in the conference room from 6:30 to 8. We'll even have some internationally themed snacks if you'd like to join us. That doesn't happen. Yeah, I know. Yeah. Yeah, later. That doesn't happen all the time, so don't get too excited. But anyway, we just are so excited by all the things that God does through this relatively small church. I don't know if you guys know that about 20% of our budget goes to missions, and that's just really impressive and exciting, and we want to do a great job of communicating the neat things that the Lord is really doing through us, which is humbling. So we hope you'll join us.
There you are. Sorry. We'll be right back. let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, Hero of heaven, You conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great things. Faithful through every storm, You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know You will do it again. For Your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, You do great things. Oh, Hero of heaven, You conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh, God, You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, You have done great things. You've done great things. For Hero of heaven, You conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, You do great things. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out Your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out Your praise. Oh, we shout out Your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross and he rose up from the grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Oh, we shout out your praise. Mercy never fails me. All of my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. Oh, I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I have been able, goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good.
By your love this day.
it's your mercy that has made me free. I'm lifted by your love to say, it's your mercy that has made me free. The beauty of your majesty, on the cross you showed your love to me. Beautiful Lord, awesome and mighty, I'm captured by this love I see. Beautiful Lord, tender and holy, your mercy brings me to my knees. It's your mercy that has made me free. Beautiful Lord.
Presence this morning. We thank you for meeting with us. We thank you for your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Grace. Always enjoy when you guys lead worship. So much that is frustrating in the world right now. You know, so much conflict. Personally, find myself, and I apologize in advance if I sometimes make these things about me, but I think many people can relate to what's going on. And so, you know, I find myself bouncing from just being mad to just wanting to go away, hopping in the car and going in the middle of the woods and just getting away from it all. Or to just scream from the mountaintops what's all the things that are wrong. Sometimes I think, well, maybe just go someplace else. Maybe I'll go to someplace that's maybe more conservative and more like-minded people, or maybe I'll find a new job, or you know, whatever it is, right? You just get tired and you just want to out. You either want to withdraw or just sometimes go to anger. And we know from our own personal relationships that's not healthy. That's not how we resolve things, and it's certainly not what Jesus did. Maybe you feel the same way. Maybe your response is different, yet all of us can probably relate to the world that we're living in. One of the things that struck me in my quiet time was a story of Daniel, and just selected as a youth, no choice, put into and indoctrinated into a king's agenda that he didn't choose, given a talent that he didn't expect, yet in the end kept his faith. He was threatened, he was forced to live in a culture that wasn't Christian, that wasn't where he may have grown up otherwise. Yet, he was able to
to turn and point folks to the Lord through his day-to-day interactions. He served the Lord through all of it. And I wonder if that's how we get out of this mess with some of us, right? Jesus came in a world that was a wasteland, right? Due to our sin, due to us and the disease that we have. And too often I think we get focused on ourselves and what's good for us. And even in the Christian context of, well, I want to be surrounded by folks, and it ends up being maybe self-focused, right? Philippians tells us 2:3, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility consider one another as more important than yourselves. And too often I think we get inward focused on ourselves rather than, in this moment I have an opportunity to serve others. In this moment that we're in, this cultural moment, we have a chance to serve and show the world via our servitude what it looks like. And it's really easy, I think, to instead complain, to instead say, well, what's going on, Lord? When in fact, we have a great opportunity. In John 13, 12 through 15, Jesus laid this out for us pretty simply, right? He was sitting down with the disciples and gathered up and removed his outer garments and tied a towel around and started to wash, right, the disciples' feet. Pick up in 13. It says, then when he had washed their feet and taken his garments and reclined at the table again, he said to them, do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are correct, for so I am. So if I, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example, so that you also would do just as I did to you, for you. Later on in verse 34, and he goes on about Judas Iscariot and the fact that he's about to go to the cross and die and be betrayed. He says, I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. And so the Lord, at least in my heart, brings us back to getting us away from our own selfishness, our own what we want out of life, and instead what the Lord has us to do. And he set that example on the cross. Jesus didn't have to come. Lord didn't have to come, but he did because he loved us. And we're called to do the same for one another, to love one another, to sacrifice ourselves as Jesus did for us this morning. Will you bow with me as we pray and take communion? Lord, thank you for serving us. Lord, thank you for coming and dying on the cross, Lord. Thank you for giving your body and your blood. Lord, the removal of the sin that we may restore relationship with you. Lord, but just not for us, Lord, so that we may serve. Lord, as you served, as you set the example, to maybe lift someone else out of their own sin, or to point someone at you, Lord, as Daniel did, as Daniel served in the spot that he was put, Lord, and did it faithfully, and others, Lord, that you've set in the Bible and that we can read about and worship. Lord, we come this morning and we worship you with remembrance of your death on the cross, Lord. Lord, help us to do that this morning. Lord, if anyone here that doesn't know you, Lord, may they let the elements pass and maybe not take them, Lord, but just consider their own nature, Lord, that we are sinners, that we aren't perfect, Lord, that sin gets in the way, Lord, of our own relationships with you, Lord, with others around us, that if we're struggling with that, Lord, how much more, Lord, we need Jesus Christ, who washed those away, Lord, who forgave us. Lord, may, if you don't know, may you just contemplate on that. Lord, for those of us who are saved, may we remember. May we remember that sacrifice, Lord, and may we take seriously the commandment that's given to us, Lord, to serve one another and to serve others. Lord, and remember the opportunity we have in this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Lord, you have been so, so good to me. Thank you, Grace. Thank you, Simon, for leading us out today. It's always a pleasure when you guys are there. So, you guys, most of you know my son, Paul Lewis. He's 13, about to be 14. But when he was 6 months old, he had a significant choking event, and he almost died. We called 911 for help, and we waited. And it seemed like it took him 4 years to get there. In reality, it was really just a few minutes. But the truth of the matter is when you're suffering, or when you're watching a child of yours suffer, or you're worried about their health, time becomes very important. And the value changes according to the situation. Well, today's passage is going to involve a lady who has waited many years to be healed, and a man who has no time to waste. Let's read the passage, if you would. You're going to turn to Luke chapter 8, verse 40. Kind of fun. Every time I set the Bible on this stand, it starts to go down. It's the weight of the word, right? All right. Chapter 8, verse 40 of Luke. Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. As Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. And then he said to her, "Daughter," she said, "Paul, you forgot your place." He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe, and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand, and he said, "My child, arise, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. Father God, we come before you today thankful for all that you've done for us, thankful for the ways that you have provided for us, for the ways that you have met our needs, and for the fact that you know us. Lord, let us not be distracted today by anything. Let us be focused on your word. And Lord, I pray that you would speak through me, that you would share what we need to hear, that you would share what we need to live our lives well this week, that we could follow you
in such a way that people would know that you are our Lord and Savior. Lord, bless us this morning. Draw us to you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, in last week's sermon, Jesus and the disciples, you guys will remember, crossed the lake to Gerasenes. I'm not going to say that right. And Jesus calmed the storm. And then he dealt with the demon-possessed man and then the demon-possessed pigs. And after that, the people of that country asked him to leave. Go back to your home. Now, this is happening right in the heart of Jesus' ministry. Right? He's performing miracles and healings. He's raising people from the dead. He's forgiving sins. He's teaching the disciples. He's traveling from town to town. And he's teaching those who will listen. And people are coming to hear what he has to say. Today's passage is going to focus on two situations, with spoken requests and unspoken needs. I want you to watch for the difference and the similarities in these two situations. Look at how they both approach the Lord with humility. Look at how they approach the Lord with humility. And then watch how Jesus responds, how he meets the needs of each. All right. We'll get started with the first two verses. Now, when Jesus returned, the crowd welcomed him. They were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came forward and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house because his only daughter, a girl of 12, was dying. And as Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him. You remember, across the lake, those guys were saying, go away, go away, go away. But on this side of the lake, there was a crowd waiting. They were anticipating his return. They had seen, they had heard what Jesus had done, that he had been healing, that he had been teaching, that he had been performing miracles. And it caused quite a crowd to gather. And they had been following him from town to town. Now, when I think of a crowd, I think of the balloon fiesta, right? It's that big, wide-open field, and there are people everywhere. But you can move around, right? You can kind of move between people. You're not stepping on anybody's toes. There's people everywhere. But I think this crowd is a little different. It's more crowded. It's not that there are more people necessarily, although there might have been, but it's tighter spaces. You know, when you think of going down the street in Albuquerque, there are 100 feet across the street between houses. But in this town, whatever town it was, the streets were probably a lot narrower. They're probably more like an alley that we would consider an alley today. And these people wanted to be close to him. They wanted to hear what he had to say, and they wanted to see what he was going to do. Now, all these people are crowded around him, and in comes Jairus. He's a ruler, a leader of the local synagogue. He was an important man, responsible for everything that happens in the synagogue. If he were here at Mountain Christian, he would determine who led music. He would pick the worship leader. He would determine who was going to get to pray and who wasn't. He carried a lot of power and authority. People would know him, and they would have made room for him to approach Jesus. This powerful man made his way through the crowd, and he humbled himself at Jesus' feet. And he asked, he pleaded, he begged, he implored the Lord to come to his house. Come to my house and see my daughter. She's only 12, and she's dying. A powerful, respected man is desperate, and his time is running out. He saw his own need, and he came to Jesus for help, for relief, for healing. And he believed that Jesus could help. He had heard the stories and the miracles. Now, when we have requests or needs, Do we bring them straight to God? Do we wait until time has run out and we have no other options? Do you completely humble yourself to the teacher? As a powerful person, as maybe you are, do you come to the itinerant teacher who has the power of God and ask him to meet your needs? Jesus went with Jairus, and the crowd followed. The passage says that they were pressing in on Jesus. If you think about that, they're bumping into each other, jostling each other, stepping on each other's toes. I'm guessing as they are traveling down the road to get to Jairus' house, the crowd has changed. It's gone from being the balloon fiesta group to being more like what you'd see at a concert. Right? If you've ever been up in front, those guys are all just crowding each other and they want to get closer. They want to get closer and they want to see and feel everything. These guys are just crushing him. Which brings us to the woman. And a woman who was there, who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her, she came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. Can you imagine bleeding for 12 years? I mean, do you have some kind of an illness or disease or affliction that affects you daily and affects you for 12 years? Diabetes, right? People get diabetes. It tends to be a lifelong affliction. But things have happened. You can take insulin. You can take medicine. You can exercise. There are things you can do to make it more livable and not as debilitating, right? Well, back then, this woman was bleeding and had been bleeding for 12 years. And there wasn't any relief. This passage, this account, is also told in Mark and in Matthew. And Mark gives us a few more details. It says that she has gone to all the doctors she can go to. She has spent all of her money. She's done everything she can. And the situation has not gotten better. It's gotten worse. Back then, when a woman was bleeding, when it was her time of the month, she was considered to be unclean. Leviticus 15 kind of lays that out about what it means to be unclean for a woman, also for a man. But when a woman has that discharge of blood, she's considered unclean until that discharge is finished. Then she could clean herself. She could again present herself before the Lord. But while she was bleeding, she was unclean. It was such that people couldn't even touch her, or they would become unclean. If she sat on this chair, nobody else could sit on that chair, or they would be unclean. Nobody could go and be around her bed where she lay down. They would be unclean. It got to the point where sometimes women would even have separate tents that they would stay in when they were bleeding. Well, that's bad enough for a week, a month. This woman is putting up with that for 12 years. She was ostracized. She was unclean to the whole community. People didn't come to her house. People couldn't touch her. They didn't want to be unclean. For 12 years, she was unable to be touched. For 12 years, people didn't come to her house, and people would avoid her. It's almost like she had cooties. But it just got worse. She's desperate, right? Her money is gone. Her options are gone. Jesus is coming. She decides, I'm going to go and he can heal me. But you know what? If I can just touch him, that will do the trick. She doesn't approach Jesus like Jairus, who came before her. She doesn't approach Jesus like the centurion in chapter 7 who sent a messenger. Rather, she sneaks up through the crowd. Maybe she thinks that Jesus wouldn't allow her to come and ask. Maybe she thinks Jesus wouldn't touch her because she was unclean. I don't really know. But I do know she sneaks through the crowd. I'm guessing she's disguised somehow, right? She doesn't want people to know, or they would all be making a fuss about, ooh, don't touch me, right? So maybe she's got a cloak on or something, and she sneaks through the crowd, not drawing attention to herself. She sneaks through the crowd. She's got to get past everybody bumping and jostling, and he's right in front of her, and she's trying to touch him, and she's stretching. She's stretching and finally touches his cloak. And immediately she's healed. Can you imagine? After 12 years of suffering, of putting everything into getting that removed, relief from that scenario, she's healed instantly. I imagine after she did that and she felt that maybe she stopped and the crowd kept moving, and her plan was just to discreetly move away, back away, let the crowd move forward, and then celebrate what's happened. But Jesus has other plans. He recognizes our unspoken needs. Jesus recognizes her unspoken need. And he says, "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." Jesus said, "But someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." And then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling, fell at his feet, and in the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. There's so many things in this situation that are incredible, but with all the people pressing in and bumping into the disciples and Jesus and touching them and all this jostling and stepping on toes and the stuff that happened, he instantly knew that she had touched him. And he asked, "Who touched me?" Did he not know who touched him and why? Did he not know what happened? No, he knew. He knew. And he also knew that her physical body was healed. But he also knew that she had other things that need to be dealt with. She had other needs that she didn't even realize that he could deal with. Her shame at being an unclean person for so long and not being touched and touching the teacher, the rabbi, her Lord. Also her guilt at sneaking up and stealing a touch. Jesus required someone to fess up. The disciples, they tried to get him to move on. "Oh, come on, Lord, we're not going to know who that is. There's so many people." No, 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 no. The synagogue's child was dying. They were under a time crunch, right? But Jesus had work to finish. "Someone touched me and I felt the power go out of me. Who was it?" And you can almost feel the excitement in the crowd. Who was it? Was it you? What happened? Did you see it? Right? They're all talking. They're all wondering. And nobody's coming forth. And finally, the woman realizes she can't hide any longer. She came forward. She humbled herself at his feet. And in front of the crowd, told them all of her need. Of her suffering for 12 years. And she confessed it all to Jesus. And she also witnessed to the crowd the miracle of her being healed instantly. And then Jesus responds, right? Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Right? She was worried that he was going to gripe at her, give her the business for touching him and being unclean. But that's not what happened. There's so many things that happened with that simple statement. He called her daughter. She's his family. She belongs. She's not to be ashamed of. She's part of my family and part of my father's family. She has the same rights as a daughter. Your faith has made you well. It tells others that she's no longer suffering from the bleeding. She's no longer to be an outcast. She's no longer unworthy to be touched. She's no longer unclean. And restores her to her community. It also demonstrates that the cloak that he's wearing is not magic. It's not the magic cloak that everybody touches the cloak and everybody's healed and better. It's not the garment. It's her faith in his power that allowed her to be healed. And her ending, his ending phrase, go in peace. Go with nothing hanging over your head. You don't owe anything. There's nothing left to deal with. Our transaction is finished. After healing her in one short statement, Jesus has resolved any shame or guilt she had. He's restored her to her community. He's acknowledged that she belongs, and he's cleared her account. He met her obvious needs, her physical and spoken needs, and he met her unspoken needs. He meets our needs, both the obvious and spoken, and our unspoken, privately held needs. What a Savior, right? Now, this passage does leave one question. Well, maybe a bunch of questions, but one that I'm going to deal with. Why did it take 12 years of suffering before this woman was healed? Couldn't she have suffered for 2 weeks or a month and then Jesus heal her? Wouldn't that have had the same effect? Well, it could have happened that way. But if you think about it, God would not have been as glorified. She may not have been as humble. She might have approached Jesus very similar to Jairus or the centurion. She wouldn't have had time to try everything. She wouldn't have had time to come to the end of everything that was humanly possible, the end of all of her finances, the end of her earthly options. She would not have been desperate for God to work through her. She may not have been the one in the crowd struggling to reach Jesus. And Jairus would not have had to wait through this scenario. God uses all things to his glory and honor, including 12 years of suffering and interrupting a crowd. So while Jesus is speaking and letting her go, we'll move on to 49. While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Time just ran out for Jairus. The messenger brought three messages. Your time is up. Your daughter has died. Two, it shows what they thought of Jesus. They thought of him as the teacher, but not more than that, and not the Messiah. The third message was, don't bother him. There's nothing he can do. Nothing he can do for you now. Jesus hears this message and he responds. Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe and she will be healed." As we expect from Jesus, he goes right to the heart of the matter. He's referring to the spoken need, the healing of the daughter, by dealing with the unspoken needs of Jairus. His unspoken needs were his fear and a lack of faith, a lack of belief. He feared for his daughter's life. He feared losing her. And he believed that Jesus could heal her. But his faith was limited to the healing. Jesus counsels him, challenges him even. Don't be afraid. Just believe. Don't be afraid. Just believe. Believe she will be made well. Jairus has seen the miracle with the bleeding woman, and he's heard much about what Jesus has done. So he knows that Jesus can do incredible things. I don't know how much time he had to think about it, but Jairus and Jesus continue on. And I'm assuming that Jairus is believing as they go. When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were waiting and mourning for her. Wailing and mourning for her, excuse me. Stop wailing, Jesus said. She's not dead, but asleep. And they laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand, and he said, "My child, arise." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. When they arrived at the house, Jesus did something that was interesting. Most often, he is doing miracles in public. Most often, he is healing people and doing things in front of many people so that people will know. Excuse me. So they'll know and can talk about and witness what he has done. But they arrive at Jairus' house, and he says, "All of you guys stay out. The only people who can come are Peter, James, and John, and the parents." You remember, they're with a crowd. And why can so few come in? I think there are a few different reasons. One, they weren't the only ones in the house. There were people already there, wailing and mourning and lamenting for the little girl, right? One reason might have been there wasn't enough room. I don't know how many people were in this crowd, but I'm sure there weren't enough room in that house. There wasn't enough room in that house for everybody. It could cause problems, right? I'm a disciple. I get to go in. Well, I'm important. I get to go in. Well, no, no. There's no fussing. Jesus says, "You five, come on. Everybody else, stay out here." Another reason might be the 12-year-old girl. Can you imagine the scene? She's on her bed. She's died. Jesus goes in and takes her by the hand and says, "Child, arise." And she stands up. And when she wakes up, she stands up. There's 45 people in her room. They're all staring at her and cheering that she's awake, that she's alive, that Jesus has done this great thing. That'd be pretty crazy for a teenage girl. The third option, I think, these parents have just lost their daughter. It's an emotional time. And then all of a sudden they get to see her brought back to life. It's a joyous occasion. It's probably pretty intimate. I figure the reason that Jesus limited the number of people is probably some combination of all three. So that brings the question is, why only three disciples? Jesus' job, his ministry on earth, well, part of that was to prepare his church and to prepare the disciples to lead his church, right? So as he's going through and teaching and performing miracles and doing these things? He's teaching and raising up this group of men. He doesn't want them to miss out on this, but he knows that 12 is probably too many people to bring in that room. So he chooses Peter, John, and James, who are oftentimes thought of as the leaders of the disciples. And he brings them in because he wants them to see what happens. He wants them to see how to handle it. He wants them to see how they should interact with those parents, with that child, how they should wield his power and authority. They don't know. I know because I've read ahead, but Jesus is about to send all the apostles, all the disciples, off two by two to go and to heal and proclaim the kingdom of God in his name, in his authority. So this would definitely be the learning experience he would hope it would be. They entered the house and they find those people in there who are weeping and grieving. And Jesus assures them, she's not dead, she's just asleep. And they laughed at him. Could you imagine somebody laughing at Jesus? He didn't even tell a stupid dad joke. And they laughed at him. I wonder how many people did that. Jesus' response to them was to walk over and to take her hand and to say, "Child, arise." Her spirit returned and she got up immediately. Now, I don't know how long she was sick or what her illness was, but I imagine she spent the last few days at least laying in the bed, not moving a whole lot, not eating a whole lot, kind of sickly, right? You guys have all seen that. Somebody's sick, they don't really feel like getting up and doing a whole lot. Well, it sounds like when Jesus told her to arise, she got up pretty quickly and stood up pretty quickly. That brings to mind youth and health, the opposite of being sick. And what does Jesus say after that? We need to feed her. Somebody get her a sandwich. The interesting thing here to point out is that Jesus didn't get food for her. He didn't even try to get food for her. But he gave somebody else that job. Jesus does many things to serve people, right? He's healed. He's taught. He's forgiven sin. He's taught about his Father. He's preparing the disciples. That was his job, his role. That was his duty. Right? It's a parent's duty or a family's duty to take care of a sick child, to provide for their needs. Right? He didn't take on roles that belonged to other people. He let them do what their job is to do, just like he does with us. Lastly, he instructs the family to tell no one what's happened. Many of his miracles occurred in public. Why would he tell them not to talk about this? Lots of people testify. The guy who was healed from the demons, Jesus told him to go home and tell people what had happened. But he's telling his parents, don't talk about this. This is not something you need to be doing. So this is a little different. Jesus limited who could come and observe, and he told the parents not to talk about it. I think the reason is because enough people would be able to share the story of what happened without the parents having to be burdened with it. They had their kid to take care of. They had their things to do. Let other people spread the word. The people who were there weeping and mourning, they could tell what happened. The disciples who were in there could tell of what happened. The crowd that followed them to the house knew why they were coming. They heard the messenger say, the girl has died. So when they saw her alive, they would know the story. They could tell. Word would spread well enough without the parents. So what do we learn from this passage? What do we take away from these two miracles? The melodic line of Luke is, who is this man? Right? It's teaching us about who Jesus is and about his attributes. So what does this passage teach us about Jesus, the Messiah? The easy takeaway would be that he's powerful, that he can heal illness, and he can overcome death. But we find that in other places. We already know that. I think there are two takeaways from this passage. The first is that Jesus knows and responds to our needs, our burdens, both the spoken ones and the unspoken. He can see our needs, where we fail, where we fall short, the obvious ones we pray about, and those that are quiet, that are hidden. He sees those and he can meet those. Now, I'm not talking about material needs. I'm not talking about prosperity or, you know, Lord, I really want a job that pays really well. I'm not talking about that. I am talking about the shame and the guilt of the bleeding woman, about restoring her. And if you remember, it wasn't easy for her. He didn't just do it and it's done. She had to participate in that. But he made it happen. I'm talking about building and increasing the faith of Jairus. Jesus used the death and the reversal of death of his daughter to make that happen. Again, it wasn't easy, right? Jairus had to hear that his daughter had died. He had to travel through town with Jesus, knowing that she had died, only to see her alive again. Jesus knew the unspoken needs of each heart, and he met those needs. Jesus met those needs. The second takeaway, Jesus acts in accordance with God's will and his timing. Jesus used both of these situations. He used them to bring glory to God, to further God's will on earth, and to meet the needs of his people. In our passage, one woman had to suffer and struggle for 12 years before Jesus gave her relief. Jairus had to suffer through the illness and death of his daughter to grow his faith. One took 12 years, one took a whole lot less. God uses all things to his good in his timing. All things to his good in his timing. Now, how do these takeaways help us today? How do they help us be better Christians, better followers of Christ? Jesus knows and responds to our needs, our burdens, spoken and unspoken. This is meant to encourage us about how personal our relationship with him is. He knows us. He knows what you're dealing with. He knows what you're struggling with, what tempts you, and what you need help to overcome. He knows us well. The second takeaway is to encourage our faith. Jesus acts in accordance with God's will and his timing. He doesn't promise that we won't struggle, that we won't suffer. As with the bleeding woman, it could last a long time. The encouragement is that you can be sure, if you are struggling, that it will be to God's glory, that he will use it in some way to bring glory to himself in this world, and it will be in his timing, his perfect timing. Trust and believe. You pray with me? Father God, we put ourselves in your hands, and Lord, we trust you. Lord, we trust you to know what we need. We trust you to help us to find those things. And Lord, we just want to be utilized for your glory. We want to be utilized to help your will move forward on this planet. Lord, there are many of us who are sick or struggling, who are dealing with things. And Lord, we just pray that we would be able to relax in your will and know that you know what's going on, that you know what the plan is, and that somehow we fit into that plan. Lord, use us this week to be your light, to point people to you, and to share your gospel with those around us. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. All right, after service, join us downstairs. We're doing fellowship down there. Oftentimes there's coffee, hot cocoa, some treats. If you get down there before Chandler does, there'll probably be some left. Anyway, it's a good place to visit and catch up. Go in peace. Have a great week.
I'm reaching for the highest goal, that I might receive the prize. Pressing onward, pushing every hindrance aside, out of my way, 'cause I want to know you.